could mean the pump, or it could mean the heart. And sometimes the heart and the pump are related, and whenever we talk about somebody who has a heart, we always clutch the left side of our chest, but that's really not what the heart is. The heart's inside. And we want to talk a little bit about the anatomy of a real, a whole person. Any of you have heard and seen this kind of a diagram? I don't know if I'm blocking anybody. But we are really a three-part whole. We have a body, obviously, a physical body. We have a soul, which is another word for the soul is the rational mind. And we have spirit, which is deep down inside that rational mind and contains what we all believe is the truth. The spirit comes to us from the universe. The spirit comes with our, when we are born, and we are constantly trying to improve the level of understanding and our level of connection between these rational areas and particularly physical areas, which are basically servants of this complex. And trying to understand what we're made of, why we function the way we function, why do we feel the way we feel. And I honestly am a neophyte at all of this in terms of understanding. Karen, I think, understands it to a much greater degree. But you can see here that there's this little red structure that sort of sits somewhere between the soul, or the personality, or the rational person, and this intrinsic spirit that we received when we were born. And that's where the heart is, at least I think, the way most physicians and most patients should think that the heart is. The pump is a physical pump that needs fixing every once in a while. But I think lots of times we get so embroiled in our discussions about pump that we forget about the real heart. And so that's what I wanted to concentrate today a little bit on discussions, at least from my perspective as a physician and a cardiologist, of treating the whole patient, not just the pump. Although the pump sometimes needs a lot of work, and we have to do a lot of things to work on that pump. If you forget who you're treating, and you forget that the real heart is somewhere embedded in the brain, we forget what we're doing, and sometimes we can get off track. And obviously, sometimes I think the patient can suffer needlessly when, in fact, creating a more positive environment, creating a more healthy, caring process might make a big difference in their outcome. So we can see a couple of things that are pretty clear. The body and its functions, its senses, the nerves, the actual physical brain, all the other physical organs, they are all outside but are connected to these elements via the nervous system. And the most common, the most important connection is through the autonomic nervous system, which is the involuntary nerves of the body, the nerves that respond to deep impulses coming from areas that like the hypothalamus and the thalamus, that are connected, we think, heavily to the spirit. So when you consider what is the relationship of the heart of the body, which is this little thing that we see right here embedded in somebody's CAT scan, there are some interesting concepts. Obviously, follow your heart, but take your brain with you is something that we've heard. Our parents tell us a lot about that. Or it takes a heart to forgive and a brain to move on. Or the one I like the most is I'm the spirit. So a lot of us act on the basis of this little heart and brain, which is some deeply connected to the inner truth, which is all positive, all about love. And it makes us do things sometimes that we oftentimes regret because the rational mind wasn't functioning at the time. Or in the case of men, sometimes the second brain doesn't think clearly. We do things that we ultimately are judged for, perhaps, or that we wish we didn't do. So I wanted to, again, just to focus the discussion. This is what, that's what the heart of the body does. This is what the relationship of the heart of the body to the circulatory pump. And as I said, there is a connection between the heart of the body, which is inside the head, and the pump, and the circulation, and the body in general. This is a syndrome called the broken heart syndrome. I don't know whether anybody's had their heart broken at some point along the way. You have?
Nobody else raised their hand.
We should probably do a CAT scan to see if this is happening. But this is a very severe situation that can happen in the setting of severe stress or severe pain. And it results from a direct connection via the autonomic nervous system to the blood vessels of the heart, and it affects the circulation of the heart. And this is an angiogram image of a patient that has suffered this broken heart syndrome. This is an image of the heart in the midst of a contraction. Remember, the heart is like this. The chambers, there's two chambers on the bottom. They fill up with blood, and then they pump and push the blood out every heartbeat. In this case, when this heart fills up and pumps, the difference between the filled up image and the pump image is very, very minimal. So this whole region has been damaged and doesn't pump so well. This region here, near the outlet of the ventricle, is pumping, but it's has also been affected, but this is the only area that's pumping. This has been described as the Takotsubo syndrome, and the reason that it does is because the appearance of this angiogram resembles these pots. These pots are Japanese octopus traps. And so the Takotsubo syndrome is a syndrome that's characterized by normal coronary blood vessels, meaning no blockage anywhere in the blood vessel. Invariably, it's a patient that's undergone some severe stress, and then they present with symptoms that are very classic and typical of a heart attack. And when you investigate what's going on, you find out that this has occurred. Normally, this doesn't occur unless blockage exists in all the blood vessels affecting the heart. This occurs as a result of intense vasospasm, spasm of the artery, and then subsequent release of the artery, leaving a damaged heart muscle, and this may never get better, may never change. It may stay like this for the rest of the patient's life, and the patient is subject to symptoms and problems related to heart failure. But this, there's no question that this comes from the connection between the heart and the brain and the heart pump. And it's an interesting connection. There are medications that can be used to help reduce the potential for broken heart syndrome. It's not Viagra, but there are medicines that can help and can help prevent an intense vasoconstriction. Some people have a tendency for blood vessel constriction, and they see blood pressure fluctuations. So the phenotype of the patient that may be subject to this can be identified earlier. And some things can be done to help prevent something like that from developing. Another, I think, interesting connection between the brain and the body that we all are familiar with is the effect called the nocebo effect versus the placebo effect. Everybody sort of remembers what a placebo effect is, right? The placebo effect is the term applied to the therapeutic or healing effect of an inert substance used to be called a sugar pill. And they used to use those things in comparison to an active medication to try to determine in some form of clinical trial whether that active medication really is having a benefit or not. But invariably, the physician or the authority figure who is administering the sugar pill is giving the person a suggestion that substance is going to aid somehow in the healing of that health, of that ailment. And as a result, there is sometimes a significant placebo effect. In other words, people who take the sugar pill oftentimes report on questionnaires that they feel considerably improved when they didn't get anything that really has any physiologic basis for action. The nocebo effect is something which I see every day in my patients. And that is, I think that this person needs a medication. Let's say it's a drug to lower cholesterol. I think they would be benefited by it. The person immediately goes and Googles the name of that medication and looks at all the potential side effects that can happen with taking that medicine. And literally the second day they take the medicine, they come in and they show me a list of every single side effect that they've experienced, and they all match the ones that are in the ones that are on the Google list. So a nocebo effect is something that should be ineffective, but which causes symptoms of ill health, and it's clearly related to the power of suggestion. Sometimes that suggestion is a self-induced suggestion. I don't typically tell people, I think you should take a tablet, and then give them a whole laundry list of side effects to watch out for. Sometimes they'll ask me, what should I look for? I tell them the major ones, but I know for sure if I tell them every single one, invariably they're not going to use that medication, or their care may be affected by that. So this is something, again, which you see all the time, and it confounds, to some degree, confounds clinical trial data that we have to try to analyze. Has anybody taken the drug or taken the substance and then immediately felt a side effect, knowing full well that that side effect may be a possibility? The term nocebo was coined in 1961 by a fellow named Walter Kennedy, and he clearly was able to demonstrate that this reaction was not related to the drug or to the substance in question, but clearly came from within the patient. And another good example of it, two-thirds of 34 college students developed headaches when they were told that a non-existent electrical current passing through their head could produce a headache. So they were involved in an experiment where they were told that they were going to have current passing through their head, and one of the side effects would be a headache. Two-thirds of them got headaches. No current. So that happens, I guess, all the time. The other interesting connection is the effect that fear can have. And pathologic fear has been attributed to what otherwise is called voodoo death. So when you see somebody with the pins, putting the pins in the doll, say, this is not a fearful situation, shouldn't be concerned. But there have been reported instances where that fear created such an intensity and lasted for enough time to trigger a connection between the visual cortex, the center of the brain, and then the autonomic nervous system, causing either cardiac arrhythmia or cardioventricular fibrillation that could lead to sudden death. So voodoo death oftentimes is a sudden cardiac death, but that doesn't happen, frankly, very often. It may happen in societies that we don't want to visit. So the intuitive mind, I love this quote, the intuitive mind is a sacred gift, and the rational mind is a faithful servant. And in our society, we honor the servant, which is the rational mind, and we have forgotten the gift, which is the intuitive mind. And that's why I think we value parents so much. Her intuitiveness and her ability to teach us to be intuitive is such a treat, such a gift. And we have to be faithful, I think, to the gift, not to the service. So when we think about things, we have to think about things from a perspective of what is the truth, what is the lucid moment, as she was saying earlier, and then react to that. Otherwise, we are doomed. Interestingly, thoughts have been proven to be able to change physical matter. And I don't know whether any of you have ever seen these photographs, but I think they're pretty striking. These are photographs of water crystals, electron micrographs of water crystals, and taken at different times. And what they did was they took water, and they would either meditate over the water, or they would put a little sticky that had a thought on the sticky against the glass that the water was in, wait a little while, take samples of the water, and then look at the crystals. And it's interesting how before a water, this is a water molecule before offering a prayer, and this is the water molecule after offering a prayer. This has been confirmed. This is just by saying the words thank you to the water, created that crystal pattern versus you make me sick, I will kill you, created that kind of pattern. But it's fascinating that when positive energy is applied to the water we drink, I mean, you think about it, human body is composed of 75% water. So every time we have a negative thought, we're making our water look like this, and it's not healthy. And the more we drink that's not healthy, the worse off we are, obviously, throughout our whole system. Thoughts can alter body functions as well. So we know we can alter physical matter with thought. We can also alter body function. This study, 94 surgical patients that were scheduled for spinal surgery were taught ahead of time how to use their mind to move blood away from the site of the surgery, to make the surgery easier, to make the less blood loss. Those that did this lost 500 cc's of blood compared to 900 cc's for those who didn't. So by focusing on the thought pattern of moving blood away from where you're being operated on helps. In this group, 100 pregnant women with breech babies, so everybody that was in the study had a breech presentation, and they were hypnotized, and under hypnosis, they were encouraged to trust their bodies and nature to restore their babies to the proper pre-delivery or head-down position. 81% of those babies that were hypnotized reverted to the head-down position compared to 48% of those that did not undergo that kind of suggestion. I think that's very striking. And finally, more recently, there was a study of patients receiving phototherapy for a disease called psoriasis. Most everybody knows what psoriasis is. It's a lousy situation. When you're, while listening to meditation guidance and instructions on visualizing ultraviolet light, slowing the division of your skin cells, which is obviously a problem in psoriasis, they're multiplying and dividing too fast. Those who did the visualizations reached the halfway clearing point 50% faster than the group that only got phototherapy without the meditation suggestion. So I think that's another very, very interesting thing. Intuition in medicine is something which is occurring daily, but sometimes it's not obvious. Sometimes the providers are not open to understanding what it is. But it frequently can occur in emergency department situations where you begin to react based on gut feelings. You have an overall sense of what's going on even before you see the lab data, before you see the x-rays, and it helps you ask additional questions, order additional tests. It helps you to take care of the patient, and there have been several studies that show that when those kinds of actions or thoughts occur before data is developed, that the outcomes invariably are better. So the voice in your head that directs your actions is something that should be listened to. Most physicians, however, don't listen to it, but somehow believe magically that this is the art of medicine. And I think that what it truly is a sign that they have been intuitive, or that they are able to intuit some of the information that is not provided to them by the science, or that is by science. There are clinical trials that are underway, I know, in cardiology to evaluate noetic science in very specific situations. Patients that are undergoing specific procedures that potentially could have an adverse consequence if they are fearful or if they are very concerned about the procedure, they're looking at ways to help them introduce suggestions that might make their outcomes better. Health teams are now being developed, particularly in the area of heart failure. And the health team not only consists of the provider that deals with the scientific fixing of the pump, but includes people that help with medication, help with suggestions that have that patient thinking more positively about their situation, potentially helping to improve blood flow to specific areas through the mind-body connection, which I think is fascinating. And I think that's going to make outcomes a lot better, and may reduce the readmission rate for patients that have significant heart problems or significant medical problems in general. I don't have much time, but I thought I can't be giving cardiology talk without showing a picture of a heart. This is obviously not a live heart, but this kind of shows you what can happen to a patient's heart when disease develops. They can go from a normal appearing size to a very large dilated size or to a very thickened size. This happens in patients that have severe high blood pressure or aortic valve disease. After a heart attack, there are shape changes that can occur going from normal to very abnormal in a matter of short periods of time. All of these things occur, and that's what focuses our attention on the heart. When we think about what may have triggered this kind of a change, we have to think about the heart and the brain as well. These are images that are now able to be obtained very readily. These are MRI images of the heart, which give incredible detail about the character of the tissue and about how it's functioning, whether or not there's been damage. These are, again, protocols that help us evaluate areas of the heart that have been damaged. These different colors represent areas that have been damaged, picked up by abnormal signals on the MRI. We don't know who the first recipient of a ventricular assist device was, but this shows you how it has evolved. These are ventricular assist devices. The one cannula is placed in the heart. One cannula is placed in the heart. The other one is placed in the aorta. So the blood is pulled out of the heart, pumped into the aorta, and essentially this whole segment of the heart is bypassed. I mean, you can get a sense of how big and bulky these original devices were just by looking at the relationship to the hands. This is what a biventricular pump looks like. It's not exactly a pretty picture. They now become totally implanted. So these are under the skin. They have an area for recharging the battery. They have a whole host of all the electronics are built out and implanted under the skin. They still have to carry around a charger pack with them, but it's a matter of just holding it next to them to recharge the battery. These are different pumps that are now used. Remember Dr. Jarvik? Remember this ad for him rowing in the river with the advertising Lipitor? He lost a lot of stock as a result of that. It was a big scandal for him. But that's his pump, and that's the that's what gets planted in the body. This is the Jarvik's control panel. I think that's kind of interesting. You can basically dial in the amount of heart activity that you want for yourself. You may like to wake up at a 3, but by then, you have that control. Let's run through the basic operation of your new artificial heart. When you wake up and you're ready to get out of bed, shift it into first gear. This is what the new heart pumps look like. I think the fascinating is small. This is now actually developed. The company is based in Hackensack in Germany, and so they're beginning to implant these. The circulate pumps are very useful and can be used to help manage a patient with severe heart failure. As an avid handyman, Lou saved some bucks by assembling his own artificial heart. But the best device, the best cardiac assist device, is a new heart. And so we're seeing a lot of decline over the years in transplantation, cardiac transplantation. But this shows the survival of transplanted hearts. Approximately 50 to 60% are still alive at 10 years, which is phenomenal compared to other forms of heart problems. But the number of transplants that are happening these days are very, very limited. Donor supply is reduced. The number, the costs are significant, so we're not seeing quite as many. So the new frontiers, we have gene therapy to consider, implantation of stem cells to generate heart muscles, smaller implantable assist devices. So the future is bright from the pump perspective, but I think we're not paying enough attention to the real heart. And I want to thank you very much for listening.
Five, maybe
mouthy and I'm talking about.
Oh, the, maybe that's the last one.
Yeah, how you went over, it bounced over.
Right there.
Yeah, I think this is important. Things are working. What can the average person do to help themselves, particularly with respect to heart and vascular disease? I think the most important thing is to eat healthy. And by healthy, it means that you need to alkalinize your body. The diet needs to be an alkaline diet because there's such tremendous oxidative production in the body. Oxidative stress is a constant factor. And then when you add to that the consumption of acidic foods, such as meats and dairy, the amount of oxidative burden and the amount of oxidative stress is huge. Obviously, loving yourself, positive thoughts about yourself and self-affirmations, I think, are incredibly important. Many, many people, when they get sick, just invalid. They're happy and vibrant, and then they get sick, and suddenly the world is going to come to an end, and it's not. But to get them out of that funk sometimes is incredibly hard. And unless you do it, their recovery is going to be significantly delayed. So you don't dwell on negative thoughts. You analyze the fears and try to deal with them. And obviously, you got to see somebody like me to help at least evaluate for the presence of processes, for example, plaque hardening or accumulation of atherosclerotic material that may be getting a little bit far ahead of you and can't control it with other means. You have to use some stopgap means that physicians or somebody like that can provide. Yeah.
If you have a plaque, how do you get rid of that?
If you have a plaque in your arteries,
how do you get rid of it? Which plaque?
The only real way to unwind plaque is through dietary restriction. There's a great book written by a fellow named Caldwell Esselstyn from the Cleveland Clinic called Prevent and Reverse Heart Disease. And basically, you eat a vegan style diet with very little meat, dairy, or oil. And over a period of 4 to 6 months, you can clearly show on angiographic images the unwinding of plaque. Hard to do, but it can be done.
What was that name again?
Caldwell Esselstyn is the author, and the book is Prevent and Reverse Heart Disease. You can get it on Amazon.
How would you suggest we go about finding a doctor that views the value of the heart as intuitive instead of just physical?
I think you need an interview, obviously, before you just throw yourself in the hand. But too many of my colleagues don't consider this important. I think when somebody compliments you and says that you have a good bedside manner, I think that's a marker for somebody that probably is thinking more along the lines of the kind of people that you want. You don't want somebody with a bad bedside manner because it's all about them and they're thinking negative. They're not promoting or pushing out the positive energy.
Complementary medicine, so you're a proponent of that.
Very much so. If someone
comes to see you, you would recommend, visualization, hypnosis, Reiki, different modalities.
Absolutely.
So great.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Now, I think they can be very, very useful adjuncts. They have to be like anything, like supplements. They have to be assigned the right priority and the right.
Put together like a listing of doctors who are intuitive. And then let's order now, and then you can go.
Or just because you want, or I want to lose 10 pounds, or whatever.